But you know you better tread carefully. Fool me twice, I'm your enemy. I'm your enemy.
Politics have always had a hand in art, or rather, art has always had a hand in politics. Whether the artist agrees and uses their work to make their stand, or opposes it and uses art as a means to challenge, the two can be linked all the way back to ancient Egypt. When people hear politics and writing in the same sentence, I'm pretty sure they picture the nonfiction section at Barnes & Noble, usually near the new releases, about biographies of a current or past president, conspiracy theories, and supportive or disruptive arguments taking one side of the spectrum or another. But nonfiction isn't the only genre presenting messages in effort to make a statement. It doesn't matter if it's a theme woven into the fictional tale of a society, or the world building of a fantasy landscape built on good and evil. Classical fiction alone shows us the kind of power fictional tales have had when it comes to societal changes. As I said before, writing is a powerful tool that I think authors in any writing community should be made aware of. But while some feel compelled to use their outlets to take a stand, others are being pressured to change their works to do the same. Some of the most powerful activists in the world are artists and writers. While I don't think people should completely erase any argument, stance, or message from their works for the sake of public opinion, I think we should take a closer look into how writers are using more invasive methods to manipulate an audience into buying their works, or how we are being pressured to manipulate said audience for messages that aren't completely sustainable. There is a reason controversy exists. Sometimes it's a straight-up disagreement, but most times it is about the gray area. Unfortunately, we live in a world today that pressures you to fall into either extreme, negating the fact that there even is a gray area, and dismissing any discussion of examples and exceptions altogether. Forcing artists to take part in a movement they might be on the fence about or don't know much about simply because it's the right thing to do is like reading the beginning and the end of a story but ignoring the middle, and it is costing the art form its identity and the artist their reputation. Whether we realize it or not, artists have had a more powerful hand in shaping societal views than we give credit for. Mostly because they go unseen, but also because a lot of people are unaware of the kind of effect they have had on society. They're kind of the undercurrent carrying with them change, history, and perspective.
Is postmodernism as destructive in this domain as in politics? The artists are the people who first articulate the unknown. And so the role of artists in a healthy culture is to bring to public awareness elements of being that have not yet entered the collective consciousness. And that's what artists do. They're problem solvers. They're problem detectors and problem solvers. That's what true artists do. You can imagine that we're all living on an island. Many of us are in the center of the island, far enough away so that maybe we can't even see the shoreline and we can't see the ocean. That's where our borders end, but we're distant from them. The artists are right on the edge. They're expanding the landscape. They're moving the culture forward. That's where my metaphor fails, I guess. They're moving the culture forward into the unknown, and they do that by translating what is as of yet unimaginable but sensed into what is at least imaginable and represented in image and drama and literature. And that's the precursor to its full formulation in articulated philosophy and thought.
Whether you're a writer, painter, or even a musician, you do have an impact. Not only can artists propose new ideas, but we can strengthen foundations and seek out new answers to problems that would otherwise go unaddressed. People tend to lose interest in a topic over time, even if it is an important one. Art helps to revitalize that subject through different angles and interests that evolve over the course of history, keeping the same topics alive through an ever-changing cycle. While it can be used to keep records of moments throughout history, it can also give a new sight into how events might have progressed otherwise. It is counterculture just by existing, by challenging what we believe, what we want, and where we're going. George Orwell, Margaret Atwood, Aldous Huxley, and Ayn Rand, just to name a few, are classical writers in what we might refer to as political fiction. Their views on the world and vision for where it might be headed helped to inspire creating these dystopian-style worlds and a new type of horror to garner the attention of people who might otherwise be unaware of this extremism. They helped us to see how far things could be taken when handing the keys of the kingdom over to the wrong person. More modern examples sprang to popularity in the early 2010s with the YA dystopian craze we fondly remember for The Hunger Games, the Divergent series, and The Maze Runner. Dr. Seuss used politics in some of his earlier satirical works as a form of activism. Unfortunately, there are also some more questionable writers who we've learned more about as far as their political views. This is what has misaligned us with so many authors we might disagree with today. Writers past have published works questionable to the morals and ideals of modern society. Poets like Ezra Pound and Rudyard Kipling, for example, have caused people to stop reading their works and start questioning their motives. Kipling for his misogyny and racism, especially after publishing The White Man's Burden, and Pound for his disturbingly positive outlook toward anti-Semitism and fascism under Mussolini, which he expressed in an 800-page poem called The Cantos. And I think this is one of the reasons why death of the author has sparked such debate in modern times. It's not just a factor of offering the financial support of a writer by buying their products, but even entertaining the ideas of the deceased concerns some people today with the level of influence they once had becoming present once again. Artists and writers don't just practice opposition, after all. They can also use their works to represent a narrative, sometimes propaganda. Given the right outlet, it can be capable of manipulating mass populations into doing a certain bidding. For instance, Nazi Germany wasted no time in attempting to gain control of the press to promote the idea of a communist uprising to help support their cause, which was just the start. By 1941, the Nazi Party's air publishing house had become the largest in German history, and their main newspaper outlet, the People's Observer, had garnered a circulation of over a million. The US later formed their own means to spark support for World War II as a sort of anti-propaganda by forming their own propaganda. In Thomas Howell's Soldiers of the Pen, we learn about a board of writers created to help promote the war effort. Founded by Rex Stout 2 days after Pearl Harbor, the Writers' War Board included prominent writers of the time such as Pearl S. Buck, Paul Gallico, and even radio host Clifton Fadiman. While government-funded, this group retained a status of being privately owned, hiring thousands of writers in effort to circulate their own form of propaganda through public appearances, radio broadcasts, and various articles. It became a sort of liaison between writers and the government, serving as another arm, and with efforts so extensive it has been called the greatest propaganda machine in history. But as I stated before, you don't have to be a political writer or supportive of a political cause in order to send messages through writing. Charles Dickens is one classical writer who opposed the poorhouses, especially during a time where liberal Victorians were criticizing the new poor law, which they felt criminalized the poor. This law was supposed to ensure that the poor were housed in workhouses, clothed and fed, children would receive some schooling, but in return, these paupers would be forced to work several hours each day. This went on to become the theme for a lot of Dickens' works, like Oliver Twist, A Christmas Carol, and Household Words. Today, the discussion over politics is taking us more and more away from the middle ground of discussion to more extremist viewpoints. To have an opinion, even a small one, on the political scale means you have to be all in for one side or the other. Today, writers have taken full advantage and made it their tool to bullhorn messages and statements that, in a lot of cases, are not so easily resolved. There are many facets and angles to consider when it comes to discussing even the most taboo of topics. But as divisive a topic as politics can be for the artist, there is another branch that tends to sink together with it in creating the perfect storm. Religion seems to have been closely linked to politics in most governments throughout history. Even when the government isn't a theocracy, both will rule side by side with an intimidating hand that could condemn a person's livelihood or one's very soul. From ancient Egypt to the Aztecs, we learned the head of the government was viewed as a god, and underneath them were council members or nobles, and usually a sort of priest that was meant to communicate to the gods on a spiritual level for the head of government to be able to speak. Throughout more recent history, England had a sort of tug-of-war between the Protestants and Catholics whenever a new king or queen was to ascend the throne, and a lot of fighting, fear, and pride came as a result. There are examples like in ancient Greece and Rome, where the politics were seen as more of an elective rather than an inheritance. Ancient Rome had two political parties for the richer and the poorer, while ancient Greece had more of a voting system set in place, even for those without military experience to have a chance at becoming a government representative. While it's easy to mistake their mythologies for the sole religion, they are more stories and legacies than an actual dictate. For the most part, both of these countries practiced different philosophies: atheism, Christianity, and Catholicism, both countries at these times being more polytheistic. Writing also has had a lot of its influence derived from various religious aspects. Cassandra Farron writes in her blog about religion and creative writing with the Westar Institute about how religion can manifest itself in creative writing in more ways than one. Her example of a Marianne Moore poem for 1921 showcases not only examples of Genesis, but also of the laurel from Greco-Roman culture used typically in rites of purification. She goes on to say, "Not every poet or writer who chooses to use a religiously charged image, such as a fig tree, must by definition be writing a religious piece. But the writer does have to reckon with the image once invoked. We don't get to make the words say whatever we want. They carry their history with them." Much like paintings by Da Vinci, the works of Michelangelo, every art form carries a piece of their time with them. In 1917, the Bolshevik seizure of Russia would forever change the nation and its literary influence. After some time in the 1920s, it became a matter of state propaganda. Publication of works had to be approved by officials and were expected to fulfill the dictates of the Communist Party in an attempt to promote their ideal of the new Soviet man. Because of tight censorship, writers were forced to either delay their works for later publication after the regime, smuggle them abroad, or circulate illegal typewritten copies. A lot of it was lost, as times later did not favor what might be representative of the past, or, more frequently, their works became unobtainable. Even officially published works promoting the Communist Party had to be altered when the party's ideals shifted and pre-revolutionary literature became harder to find. Where once the Russian people had been aware of Western trends during the Soviet period, contact and travel were heavily restricted, further affecting the output of writing during this time. Religion has become a strong foundation for determining the people's will. It helps to shape a person's core virtues, and that in place has an effect on what we decide at the polls. Representatives advocating for certain policies, changes, and primary focus usually have to adapt to one side or another in order to align themselves with the people who would vote, and this separation is responsible for so much anxiety today. These topics are so divisive, even at family gatherings, and can change the viewpoint one has of another person entirely. But why? While religion has a heavy influence, when it comes to elective voting, we all have a say. Most people who are religious have been brought up to believe a certain way, no questions asked, and when others begin asking those questions, they are usually condemned. This has created a bitter divide between those who firmly believe in their core values, often brought up since childhood, and those who would believe in a more open-minded society. But we all have some level of influence when it comes to who gets position in office, who gets to represent us, and who gets the power to make the changes opposing parties believe need to happen. With that power comes a great responsibility that is often overlooked or misjudged simply because of labels being thrown at each other in an attempt to shut down the conversation. It is here where the artist gets caught in the crosshairs.
For those of us who are put on this earth as artists, we are designed to engage with the impulses of life through creating. We cannot fully engage with that impulse unless we've created something from it, right? That creation will sometimes be a depiction of the impulse. Sometimes it'll be a rebuttal to the impulse. That creation can be the reason for it, or maybe it's an exploration of a question which the impulse inspires within us.
The truer the art, the more it can reveal truth, with a capital T. To be called to the religion mountain means your vocation, your life, is in ministry, specifically, you know, pastors, missionaries. Our job is to identify the sphere of culture that we are called to and rise in influence within it. This isn't about being famous. This isn't about being a culture shaper. It's about being people of influence. What is the sphere of influence that you are called to? 9 times out of 10, it's answered in this question: what do you want to be when you grow up? If you're in this room, it's likely that your sphere of influence will be in the arts and entertainment. It's a fundamental misunderstanding of art and of the Great Commission to look at the products of the art sphere as a means to gain influence in the religion sphere. What I'm not saying is that we cannot utilize one mountain in the service of another, or that there is not overlap. There is. There's two men named Alex and Stephen Kendrick. They make movies, Courageous, Facing the Giants, Fireproof. Whether you like their movies or not is not the point. These men are preachers. They are not filmmakers. They will tell you, I know them, I have worked with them. They will tell you, we are not here to make art. We are not here to make movies. We are here to build up the body and preach the gospel. We use film to do it. As a result, they are gaining influence. Where? Not in arts and entertainment. They are gaining influence in religion. They have great favor in arts, but their influence is in religion because that is their calling. It's not about one being right and the other being wrong. Bad art happens when we misidentify our calling.
I think one of the biggest mistakes an artist can make is compromising their output for a message they want to send. It doesn't just have to be about politics. It can be about religion, education, or personal opinion. We've already covered how effective art can be as an outlet and how powerful of a tool it is, but what if that piece wasn't originally created to portray these messages? What if the creator doesn't believe in these statements wholeheartedly, but is being pressured by companies to put out something with more substance, or else it wouldn't sell? What if the piece has a different message built into its structure that is being pushed off to the wayside for another to be shoehorned even if it feels out of place? I used to read a lot of Christian fiction, especially growing up, and writers like Kim Vogel Sawyer, Mindy Sterns Clark, Jeanette Oak, and Francine Rivers are still among my favorite writers for one simple reason. They did not compromise the story for the sake of the message. A lot of Christian fiction today is, typically, aligned with the good news, and even though it has been spread, it's as if this is the only message meant to be relayed to the public. Much like the movies created, that message is almost always the same, to the point where the characters end up feeling like paper cutouts of either bad guy or good guy. And the statement is always, bad guy does bad things until good guy comes along to tell him it's bad and then he becomes good. The most frustrating thing for me growing up was how flat and boring a lot of these stories were, despite having an entire Bible to draw inspiration from. It's rather eerie then to see so many forms of entertainment today taking that same route, except instead of evangelism, it's politics. Art has become less about free expression and personal exploration to becoming more of an industrialized version of what it used to be. I know this video was supposed to be about AuthorTube, and I will get there. But first, I want to talk about BookTube. It isn't a problem that politics exist in art, but it becomes a problem when the artist is required to either compromise their ideas for someone else's message, force their truths to wrap around a certain narrative, or become the example for big companies to squeeze one more into a collective category for one group or another in an attempt to not look biased, I guess? I'll say this. There is nothing wrong with activism at all. I think it is important to stand up for minorities or to have difficult conversations about topics that a lot of people for a long time have brushed under the rug. I think it is admirable when someone goes against the grain to get out their truth via an own voices novel or a controversial picture. However, whenever political swing happens, populations are pressuring artists more and more to vocalize their stance, which will either have them praised or condemned. There is a rumor that writers are being forced to be more inclusive or to write outside their comfort zone in order to appease a fan base already skeptical of their consumerist intentions. This proves to be a double-edged sword when writers who may be inexperienced in these areas don't quite live up to the standards of this newer fan base the industry is trying to appeal to. What further complicates this is when readers demand more from writers who may either be unqualified or they simply don't have the desire to circulate their pieces around the messages. Here we come to that good old argument, do writers write for themselves, the fan base, or the greater good? The idea of writers writing for an active political movement when they aren't compelled to do so of their own volition creates this toxic sort of cycle that will only repeat itself. For instance, if you are already a part of a group that is pushing for you to use your outlet as a means to get out their message, then it becomes an own voices work. But in order to push that work, most will use that own voices label as a promotional gimmick, which means the work would have to revolve around the message in order to appeal to this demographic. You might be drawing in from another audience, but their expectations are going to be less about the substance of that work and more about the message. Meanwhile, you risk losing audience members who originally were there for the entertainment factor, which could result in losing future works to the wrong audience. The only way this would be beneficial for your career is if your primary goal is to switch demographics. If you aren't an own voices writer or artist, but you're told to be more inclusive, then it's another kind of compromise. One could put in the time to research and seek out resources or people who have experience in a certain area in order to be as accurate as possible, but a lot of these cases still receive scrutiny. This is why BookTube in particular has been coming under fire for the last 5 or so years. It would seem a lot of readers want to become activists, and they do so by putting down poor examples of the movements they are trying to show support. Their focus is being taken farther away from the art form itself, and instead of using certain topics as talking points, they are brought up for condemnation, scrutinizing the writer, staining their reputation, and attempted bullying to have an effect on their career. Whether these writers deserve support or not, it is the tactics being used by BookTubers that a lot of people are starting to question. There is a lack of empathy and understanding, and there is little realization when it comes to finding out some people still do have closed-minded ideals. Some people still have prejudice and even a stereotypical outlook on things. Instead of using this as a learning moment, we shun the outliers. But as superficial as they may be, BookTubers aren't the only ones taking questionable measures to make their stand. I wish I could say AuthorTube is a community of writers who don't abuse politics, but there are a few who are more than a little forward when it comes to vocalizing their thoughts, usually in a passive-aggressive manner. It isn't a political debate at that point, it becomes a rock-throwing contest. This might include the common cis-white male or old white men terms made in some of Jenna Maresi's videos that are commonly used to accuse any haters of misogyny, and therefore shuts down any merit said criticism might hold. This is usually made into a joke, but it can be just as harmful to direct said hate to people in the audience who might be old. Or a cis, or a white male. And the flippant use of these terms come off as an insult to anyone who might be a part of this demographic, as if being such are outsiders to the club.
Seven, sexual assault made me stronger. I know you're all thinking about Game of Thrones. Poor Sophie Turner was done dirty with those lines. But this is a trend that's been going on for eons, and it's almost always perpetuated by male writers. Male writers! Stop it! Femme Fatale finally breaks down and shares her story, revealing that she was gang raped in her past, and that's why she's the badass she is today. Someone please feed these writers to sharks, I beg you. Sexual assault is a widespread problem, and it affects a lot of women. But turning it into a Phoenix story is offensive. Four, the sage magical mentor. He's usually white, definitely male, possibly a wizard, and pretty damn old. Ask any woman about their experience with old white men who want to mentor them, and I guarantee it'll be the most audacious, ridiculous bag of shit you ever heard. Seven, my writing doesn't cater to the PC police. In other words, I want to write racial slurs and you can't stop me. Listen, regular people don't care about the PC police. And that's for one obvious reason. They're not bigots. Are seen as more expendable than straight characters. Overall, queer characters are more likely to die than straight characters in media. They enjoyed it. The character told them to stop, but they fell victim to seduction. Dubious consent is not sexy. It just makes the scene gross and uncomfortable.
Hey, your worship, I'm only trying to help.
Would you please stop calling me that?
Sure, Leia.
Oh, you make it so difficult sometimes.
I do, I really do. You could be a little nicer, though. Come on, admit it. Sometimes you think I'm all right.
Occasionally, maybe.
Afraid?
You're trembling.
I'm not trembling.
You like me because I'm a scoundrel. There aren't enough scoundrels in your life.
I happen to like nice men.
The token black character, and the black character dies first. I put these two together because they come down to a common denominator. These characters are included so the writer can say, "Here you go! I did it! I wrote a black character!" Bridge a woman means to kill a female character, usually a wife or a girlfriend, in order to motivate a male character or advance his hero journey. Now, plenty of characters are killed to advance a plot, but fridging a woman is a wee bit different. The female character is reduced to a plot device. Her sole purpose is to die a painful death so the male character can become a hero. Five, inspiration porn. Inspiration porn refers to a disabled or neurodivergent character who exists to inspire the reader. Wow, look how challenging their existence is! But Jenna, I can't write a mentally ill villain? I don't know, can you?
No, Helen.
Is that a raincoat?
Yes, it is! In '87, Huey released this. before.
Their most accomplished album.
I think their undisputed masterpiece is Hip to Be Square.
A song so catchy, most people probably don't listen to the lyrics. But they should, because it's not just about the pleasures of conformity and the importance of trends. It's also a personal statement about the band itself. Hey, Paul!
Taking daddy's money, buying your dollies and your knickknacks, and eating his fucking chicken, fattening up like a prize fucking heifer. You change the scenery, but not the fucking situation, and the warden makes house calls.
My father loves me.
I bet. With every inch of his manhood.
Oh, God. You're just jealous, Lisa. Because I got better. Because I was released. Because I have a chance. And a life.
They didn't release you because you're better, Daisy. They just gave up.
Comedy is subjective, Murray. Isn't that what they say? All of you, the system that knows so much, you decide what's right or wrong the same way that you decide what's funny or not. If it was me dying on the sidewalk, you'd walk right over me. I pass you every day and you don't notice me. But these guys, what, because Thomas Wayne went and cried about them on TV? Nobody's civil anymore. Nobody thinks what it's like to be the other guy.
You finished? I mean, there's so much self-pity, Arthur. You sound like you're making excuses for killing those young men. Not everybody, and I'll tell you this, not everyone is awful.
You just wanted to make fun of me. You're just like the rest of them.
You don't know the first thing about me, pal. Look what happened because of what you did, what it led to. There were riots out there. Two policemen are in critical condition. You're laughing. You're laughing. Someone was killed today because of what you did.
I know. How about another joke, Murray?
No, I think we've had enough of your jokes.
What do you get?
I don't think so.
When you cross a mentally ill loner with a society that abandons him and treats him like trash!
Call the police,
I'll tell you what you get!
Call the police!
You get what you fucking deserve!
It appears unprofessional, and by definition, sexist. But I guess we should be used to that by now. BookTube has never really shied away from expressing their disgust to aged members of the opposite sex, as if men can't be bullied off the platform fast enough and their presence alone is a virus to the community. The issue with most speakers, creators, or artists these days is the extremist attitude with which these subjects are being addressed. Nothing is ever a black and white issue, and there are always other factors or exceptions to consider. But in most cases, these are thrown out almost immediately whenever someone wants to even have a discussion about the topics that expose it as not being an all-or-all conversation. Some of the most powerful activists are writers. And I think this is why someone like J.K. Rowling, with such a huge influence and platform, being an activist, has sparked so much debate and even hate. She became something more than just the author of the beloved Harry Potter books, but someone with the power to influence entire generations. And that has concerned two major branches now, one in religion, and now one in politics. While I can disagree with a writer on either end, a lot of people are conflicted about it and voice their opinions to spark conversation. This is a good thing, to get out different perspectives and examples, to try to reach a middle ground and better chance to find more moderate solutions rather than extreme ones that would have us turn a blind eye to negative cases on either side of the spectrum. My problem isn't the fact that writers can be prominent activists, but rather the methods some are using in order to make their stand. I'm sure most everyone is well aware of the Roe v. Wade recently being overturned, and naturally, the country is in an uproar. Those who are pro-choice and those who are pro-life have practically been at each other's throats since the beginning. Pro-choice believers hold to the argument that the government should not have a say on what medical procedures should or shouldn't be optional for their bodies. It feels invasive and abominable, on top of the idea that those forced to seek out less safe procedures would put more women at risk. Not to mention those victims of sexual assault or incest now possibly forced to carry to full term. On the flip side, you have those who are pro-life, who believe that the fetus is a separate body, a separate being with a separate heartbeat and pain receptors that have no say in whether or not they are given a chance at life. The gray area is kind of where people are discussing the different terms, different procedures, and measures that could be taken to prevent these procedures, which often feel like they are being disregarded and abused for the sake of one's own impulses. Around this time, Courtney from the Courtney Project proposed an anthology charity meant to donate proceeds or work to support reproductive rights. Now, unlike J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter series, it would appear this anthology is sending its funds directly to support a cause that not everyone is going to agree with. While it is vague as the cause with which Courtney stands, the picture posted kind of speaks for itself. Apparently, she came under fire with some people feeling the need to use their voices to take their stand on the political spectrum because she later released this post, claiming she had no intention of talking politics, getting to debates, and wasn't trying to change minds or alienate anyone. But it's kind of made clear from her edited comment to Courtney Fraser, this might have been the case. It kind of feels like she's turning writing, which is supposed to be a free expression of self, into a weapon, and even going so far as to criticize those who might disagree for going against their core beliefs, just because they want to sign up for an anthology project, and then pretending like the two aren't linked. It's fine if you want to take a stand for something you believe in, and if you want to organize a project to support that cause, also fine. It's not considered brave if one has to double down and lie about their intentions to try to simmer down any tempers invoked. Art is true expression, free expression, and the writing industry has fallen trapped to the hijacking of capitalist marketing to feed our consumers with more of the same, to push these same messages that have blasted us for years with little room for doubt or consideration. As writers, I believe it is of the utmost importance to research any argument or statement you are planning to present in your story for two reasons. One, there are two sides, two arguments, and two different perspectives to address if you want to keep members of the both parties in your audience. And two, having that strong foundation for your argument is the best way to convince someone else to see things from your point of view. Keeping these items in consideration when writing will help strengthen your viewpoint as well as those who share it. It will promote respectability and maturity when it comes to having these arguments, and it presents a new perspective that isn't so pungent to those who might disagree. But sometimes the punch in the face can be an effective method to get that message across, especially when we're talking about readers who don't know how to read between the lines or can't pick up on the subtlety. Obviously, this was a lot to get into for this video, but it won't be the last time I bring it up. There are, after all, many different avenues and angles to explore when it comes to discussing activism, politics, and religion in writing. No matter how open-minded we might try to be, these topics will leak into our psyche and our works. They are a part of us, our history, and our core beliefs. It isn't a bad thing, and if we want to experience any change in our society, it is vital to share these perspectives and have these conversations, no matter how difficult. That being said, I think we should write with a certain level of awareness. Most importantly, the consideration for our audience and what exactly we want to represent. If you are interested in writing political fiction directed to target the demographic of a certain party, then come up with the material to make your stand stronger or more prominent. If you simply want to tell stories for entertainment, create a boundary with yourself and how far you want to take that line, how much you want to be ready to engage, and prepare your audience for that. We're writers. Whether we agree or disagree with each other when it comes to topics like politics or religion, one thing remains true. We have armed ourselves with the same weapons, and what matters is how we use them.